to do duet forever.
Well, I saw her up there. She went like this. So I thought, well, it's my cue to come up. So anyhow, well, we're glad that you're here today. What a beautiful day to have church outdoors. Aren't you glad you're here today? What a wonderful cathedral, God's cathedral, where we can worship Him and honor Him today. How many, this is your first time here from, you're up north, and this is your very first time in our service today? Let me just see your hand. No, I know a lot of our wonder folks are here. I see that hand. Amen. I see that hand. I feel like I'm Billy Graham. I see that hand. Yes. Well, welcome to Outdoor Church. We're so glad that you're here. And let's stand as we open the service in prayer. And ask God to come and minister to us in a very special way. We've been preparing all week for this service, and so we're glad that you're here today, and we feel like we have a word from the Lord from you, and we got our songs that we can lead you in worship, and let's connect with God Almighty today. Can we do that? Let's pray. And I tell you, here's how I want us to do. I want us to open the service this morning by reciting the Lord's Prayer. Can we do that? Let's do that together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen and amen and amen. Well, turn around and greet one another with a touchless greeting by saying, God bless you. Jesus loves you. Can you do that? Give a wave to people around you. We got them scattered throughout the park today. So we welcome you today. Appreciate you coming out. You may be seated. Go ahead and take your seat. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we want to welcome you. And in your bulletin, there's an envelope. All of our first-time guests, just take a moment, fill that out during the service, and then drop it in the offering at the end of the service. We want to be able to reach out to you. Or you can bring it up to our desk up here, either way, and there's a free gift for all of our first-time guests. My wife is there, and Tammy, she's holding that up. So go ahead and pick up one of your free gifts. Offerings are going to be, buckets are going to be out throughout the park on the table there, so you can drop your envelope in there. All of our first-time guests, we appreciate you coming out. And we want to welcome our online church, Park Church. Give a hand to our online, give a hand to the people out here. And we welcome you today. We got a good audience that taps in every week. Please download the sermon notes, the songs, create your little worship service there. Also, we're going to do communion today. So make sure you have something. You have a cracker, a cookie, a chocolate chip cookie, a wafer, or something, a juice. And join us as we have our communion today. And just a couple things. We're going to dismiss the kids after a praise and worship. So make sure, and we'll give you those instructions on that. We're going to have them in our praise and worship, and afterwards we'll dismiss them. And look in your bulletin. There's a number of events that are taking place that are scheduled in the future, so you can keep in tune with that. And then next week, we're going to have to relocate, can you believe it, Art in the Park. Now, this is what we're going to do. We're going to go over to the Lions Club. Everybody point over there, Lions Club. But we're going to be outside. So we're going to do church outside in the parking lot there, so instead of bringing it inside. So just giving you that little tidbit, which means you can park over there, and also you can park across the tracks there, you know, and walk across Pennsylvania. So letting you know that, next week there will be tents all over the place, and there will be art in the park, but we're going to have service over there. Where's the service? Over there. So it's right over there by the Lions Club. Go ahead, and also we need some parking attendants. If you can help us with that on your envelope, we need parking attendants for that service. And also people that would like to set up, we put you on a schedule. We do set up here. We come here about 8:15 in the morning, and we need some folks to help us with that. We'll put you on the schedule. You don't have to do it every Sunday, but we do need some help on that. And also greeters. And so if you feel led to do that, just put on the on your envelope greeting or ushering or parking attendant, and we'll get with you this week. Go ahead and take your notes out, or your songs, and let's worship the Lord today as Wendy comes to lead us in our praise and worship.
Amen. Hallelujah. I don't know about you guys, but I think 2021 is going to be a good year. Amen? Yes, I can feel it.
I meet with you, and my soul sings out as your word flows down far away.
Amen.
I sing to you, and my heart cries, holy, hallelujah. Father, you're near. Lord, we know my hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by trial or storm. The peace that passes understanding is my song, and I sing, my hope is in you, Lord. I wait for you, and my soul finds rest in my selfishness. Lord, you show me grace. Thankful for your grace, Lord. Yeah. I worship you, and my heart cries glory. Hallelujah. Father, you're here. And Lord, we sing, our hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by drought or storm. The peace that passes understanding is my song, and I sing, my hope is in you, Lord. I move my heart to you. Father, we just thank you this morning that you are you're our refuge, Lord. I declare I will wait on you, Lord. You are you're my refuge. Lord, we know our way on you, Lord. We declare this morning, Father, that you are our refuge. You're our hope, our strong tower. And we run to you this morning, amen. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by trial or storm. The peace that passes understanding is my song. I sing that my hope is in you, Lord. And Lord, we sing, our hope is in you, Lord. And we sing, our hope is in you, Lord. Oh, Father, we declare that our hope is in you this morning. Hallelujah. Oh, give him some praise, church. Father, we magnify you this morning. Oh, we lift you up. You are a good God. Amen. How many can testify to that this morning, that we serve a good God? Father, we thank you for your faithfulness this morning. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, Father, thank you for inhabiting our praises this morning. You are worthy to be praised. In all these pieces, broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole, empty-handed, but not forsaken, I've been set free. Been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Ooh, oh, I once was lost, Lord, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. I can see the love in your eyes. I can see the love in your eyes, Lord. In laying yourself down, in raising up the broken to life.
Father, we exchange our brokenness this morning for your wholeness. Oh, Jesus, be magnified, Lord. We love you. We love you so much, Lord. You take our failure and you take our weakness and you set your treasures in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Ooh, I once was lost, Lord, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see, Lord. Oh, I can see it now, Lord. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes. We thank you, Jesus. You laying yourself down, oh, Lord. You raising up the broken to life. How many are surrendering this morning to Jesus? Amen. Father, we surrender our broken pieces in our lives, Father. We surrender where we're coming up short. Father, take us higher. Hallelujah. Let this be the year of breakthrough. Let this be the year of no more halfway living. Hallelujah, Father. Take us higher in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Ooh, I once was lost, Lord, but now I am found. I was blind, but now I see. Oh, the amazing grace, Lord, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Ooh, I was lost, Lord, but now I am found. I was blind, but now I see. Oh. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen and amen and amen. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. Well, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
What a blessing. My name is Susan Fannin.
And I'm Larry Fannin.
And we are both pastors, and we love serving God and making disciples and see life transformation. What a blessing it is to gather here this morning. It's good to see you all. What? Look at, everybody's filling the whole park. We believe the Lord led you here to be seated right where you're at and to hear what you're going to hear. We want to thank Simon and his family for being here. We're just going to lay our hands towards him today, and we're going to pray a blessing over him. We're thankful for his family to be here with us. He's battling cancer, but we believe God to heal and restore and make things new. So, Lord, bless Simon now. Thank you for his family. Thank you, Lord God, for your healing power. Thank you, Lord, that by your stripes we were healed. Thank you, Lord God, that you raise the dead, you heal the sick, you make the lame to walk and the blind to see. So, Father, thank you for your amazing grace to pour over Simon and his family as they continue to seek you, Lord God, for healing. And we praise you and we thank you for his healing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thanks for being here. Well, we're excited to talk to you this morning about kicking off the new year. How exciting it is. And you know what? It's not just a New Year's resolution. Nope. It's a New Year proclamation, a proclamation of faith, where we can proclaim that the Springs Church of Bonita is a place where you can learn to be a follower of Jesus. We're together, we're the body of Christ, where we are followers of Jesus, where we come together as the family of God and we're drawing closer to God and to each other. Turn around, look at somebody around you and say, I like you.
I like you too.
Well, we're going to have an opportunity in this year of 2021 to go deeper in our faith, deeper in our hope, and deeper in our love. As followers of Jesus, we're going to learn from God's word. Each of us can read God's word. We can. And now we're offering to you an opportunity to join together to do what's called SOAP, where we can read together. You have one in your program. You're going to get one every month. What a blessing it is to read God's word with SOAP. That stands for the scripture, your observation of what's going on, the application, how does it apply to your life, and how to pray through it. Here he is. It's right there. So this is a tool for you to use each and every day to hear from God. This morning we read in Genesis and in Matthew. So please take it home. Lay it out where you can see it. Pull out your Bible, get a notebook, and follow along. It's good to get into God's word. We also have small groups here, and one Nick has on Mondays and Wednesdays studying the book of Ephesians. So we'd love to have you join that. That's in your bulletin also. All right. Now we'd like to share with you about an opportunity that's coming up. How about you say, yay! All right. Ready? Here's the opportunity. The opportunity is to partake in 21 days of prayer and fasting together.
Fasting.
What did she just say? Fasting? Oh my gosh, yes. Now many of your hearts are pounding right now. You're thinking, what? Fasting? Is that what she said? I can't fast. Well, you know what? The truth is, yes, you can. And the Bible says that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So everybody yell, yes, I can.
Yes, I can.
What? Did you hear them? I didn't hear. Yes, I can. Yes, you can. You have a sheet in your packet that's part of our program, and it'll tell you a little bit about different ways to fast. Doesn't mean we're just calling you out right now that all of you are going to not eat and you're not drinking for 21 days and we're going to come check your house and follow up with you. No, it's a time for us to seek God and ask Him, what should I do? What would you have for me? You're going to learn so much in the next few weeks about prayer and fasting. You can pray about it. If necessary, check with your doctor. But let's talk about it. Let's look what that would be like for each one of us. See, a fast is where you give up something and you receive something. Do you desire to see the move of God more in your life? I do, all the time. And this is our opportunity this year to hit that reset button, to be able to check with God and be transformed from the inside out. Because that's where our soul cries out, Lord, change me, move in me. Now, we have time. We're not doing this tomorrow. We're going to begin on Monday, January 18th. Everybody say, January 18th. Okay, we're going to have 3 Sundays to talk about it and prepare about it. You're going to learn more and more about what's coming up, and we desire to do this together. We're going to seek God and become more aware together of our need to be strengthened spiritually and to connect with God, learning His will and His way in our lives. What a great way to start the new year. Jesus had disciples. They followed Him. They loved Him. They were eager to be with Him, to learn from Him, and their lives were changed. So can yours and mine. We can be transformed and changed. Well, Jesus met with His disciples at Passover, and they partook of communion. And today, we're going to do that also. And Larry's going to share with you more about that.
So yes, Jesus and His disciples, they gathered together. And just like we gathered together today.
Sorry, we're blown away.
We're blown away here. They were blown away. Now, this is your opportunity, as Jesus did, for us to draw closer to one another and to Him. So maybe you need to make some changes in your life. Maybe there's something that you desire to maybe to fellowship more with God or to study more, to read more. Well, this is an opportunity this morning when you take communion to make that commitment. Oops, sorry. By the way, does everybody have a communion cup? If not, please raise your hand and someone will bring you one. There's a couple over here. So as you take your communion cups, oh, you've already done that. And also, some of the online is, as Pastor said, if you want to grab something so you can join us with communion, we'd love to have you do that. But I invite you, as you peel back that label over the bread, that layer, just hold on to the piece of bread and think about it. Think about taking a moment to receive this communion. Think about Jesus breaking that bread and sharing it with his disciples. This morning, think about Jesus is breaking that bread and he's sharing it with you. Today, he's passing it out to you. For just hold it for a moment and think about that. Jesus is sharing it with you. The Bible says, on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, and so let's just do that quickly. Thank you, Father. Thank you for sending Jesus to die for us. Then he went on to say, he broke it and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Take and eat now. Now open the cup. The Bible goes on to say, then after eating, he took the cup and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. As often as you do this in remembrance of me. Take and drink. Let's pray. Dear Lord, today, we thank you for giving us the opportunity to draw closer to you by worship, by reading of your word, by prayer, by fasting, and by sharing communion. Father, please help us grow deeper in our faith as individuals and as a church as we move into this coming year of 2021. Thank you for our pastor, Russ. Lord, we ask you to open our hearts to hear and to receive his message on your promises about our future. And Lord, just as we prayed this morning for health and for healing, for Simon, we pray it for each and every person that's here in this park, that's watching us online, for our family, for our friends. For we believe, Lord, that you are a God of healing, a God that loves us, a God that wants to touch us in every aspect of our life. So have your way, in Jesus' name. Well, thank you for sharing communion with us, and thank you for being a part of the family of God.
Amen. Let's hear for our pastor, Susan and Larry. Love you guys.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changes a lot, thy compassions, they fail not. Yes, thou hast been, thou forever will be. And great is thy faithfulness. Sing it with me. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. In Lord, I have needed thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Oh, yeah. In summer and winter, in springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. Enjoyed with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. In love heavenly did thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Mm-hmm. We just praise you, Lord. We thank you. Oh, hallelujah. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence. In pardon for sin, and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, and blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Amen. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Lord, I have lifted thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Sing it out. Great is thy faithfulness. Lord, we declare, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. In all I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Thank you, Wendy. Aren't you glad for God's faithfulness? Amen. I'd like to dismiss the kids at this time. All of our kids, go ahead and be dismissed. And you have my wonderful wife, Angelia, that's going to be doing the kids' church. Travis and Stephanie will be back next Sunday. They took a couple weeks off to be with family up north, so we missed them. But you are in able hands with my wife. She was a children's pastor for many, 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 many years. And so she knows how to do that very well. I'd like to encourage you to go ahead and take your outline. You'll find that in your bulletin today. And those of you that are watching us online, make sure you download the notes there, because we're bringing up, we're going to have a brand new message series on God's promises, God's amazing promises. You know, somebody counted that there are 7,000 promises in the Bible. So we're going to look at all 7,000 of them today. Turn to your neighbor and go, oh, boy. We might as well just let the Methodists beat us at males, and we'll be there by one, okay? But I'm just kidding with you right there. There are, somebody counted over 7,000 promises. But today we're going to look at some of these promises, and particularly being that this is our first Sunday of 2021, we want to look at God's promises about your future and about my future. God has a lot to say about it. One thing, and I wanted to start this out by saying this, the rest of your life is in your future. Do you believe that? The rest of your life is that way ahead of you. not that way, behind you. And none of your life is left in the past or even today. But here's two things about your future. You don't know what's going to happen in your future. Who knew 2020 would be like this? And number two, you can't control what's in your future. So I definitely would be interested in what God has to say about your future, about my future, because none of us know what's going to happen tomorrow or even today. And as we approach 2021, I want to give you some promises of God as believers as we look into 2021. And it'll give you, hopefully, it will encourage your heart and your faith today to see what God says. So, well, before we get into the six promises of God, let's look at four facts about your future on your outline. Let's lay a little foundation as we enter 2021. Fact number one, what the Bible says about your future, God knows everything that will happen. That's what you want to write down. God knows everything what's going to happen. He knows the beginning and the end. I'm going to give you a theology word. It's called the omniscience of God. God is all-knowing. There's nothing that God doesn't know. In fact, God, you know, in a practical sense, that means God's never surprised. God never goes, wow, I didn't see that coming. You know, like, ooh, ouch. You know, my bad. I missed that. You know, no, God knows everything that's going to happen. God knows everything what's going on in your life. And he already knows the end of our lives. How does he know that? God is not limited by time. God is timeless. My concept of time happens when, because we're on this planet and we turn around every 24 hours and it goes around the sun every 365 days of the year. But God is timeless. God can be in the past, God can be in the present, and God can be in the future all at once because God isn't linear. It's all the same to him. It's a matter of perspective. Look at Hebrews chapter 4 on your outline. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. In other words, he sees it all. Everything is uncovered and lays bare before him his eyes. In other words, there's no secret with God. You know, I wonder what secrets you're foolishly thinking you're hiding from God. God knows everything, every good, every bad, every ugly. And God, guess what? He still loves you. It's unconditional love, God's unconditional love. Look at Psalms 139 on your outline. The days allotted to me, in other words, my lifespan, has all been recorded in your book before. Circle that word before. Any of them ever begin. You know, God already knows what's going to happen on every day of your life before you even took your first breath. When you were in your mother's womb, God says, I already knew every detail of every second of every moment in your life. And so we see that God knows all that's going to happen in our hearts ahead of time, in our hearts and in our lives. And that's why from a biblical worldview, you know, why abortion is wrong. Because abortion short circuits God's plans. And so God's plan for your life doesn't start the moment you take your breath. It starts the moment that every day of your life, God thought you. Your life begins when God thought you up. And we see that in here. And we see God's plans in your life. It's a good plan. It's a wonderful plan. And it's a plan for us in our hearts and in our lives. Look at fact number two about the future. God's plan for my future is good. God has no bad plans for God, for people, for his people, because God's a good plan. Look at Jeremiah 29 on your outline. Let's read this together. Can we do this together? Read this all together. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Can you circle the word know? He says, I already know everything is going to happen. He already knows. Circle that. Circle the word plans there. God has some long-range plans for you. And plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans of hope in a future. I want to say, as Christ followers of Jesus Christ, we should be the most confident people walking into 2021. Because God has that type. That's a great promise for you to have to write in your Bible there. God's brought you. You know, God thought more about your future than you have. A lot of times we don't even think about 2020. We don't even give much thought about the future. But God has thought about every detail, every thought, every part. He has your life planned. And he has a good and a plan to prosper us and a plan to give us hope and a future. Someone says, well, can I miss God's plan? In fact, most people do. They miss God's plan because they choose to follow their own plans. You have to choose God's plan. It's not automatic. You know, God gives us a great gift, and it's called the freedom of choice. And God could have made us so that we didn't have any choices, so that we wouldn't have to make any bad choices, but we were made in His image, and He gives us a free will, and every day we make choices. And the problem is, often we do make bad choices. God doesn't force His plan or purpose into our life. He wants His children to choose to love Him. And so God says, hey, you can choose to love me, or you can choose not to love me. You can choose to obey me and trust me, or you can choose not to. Just to give you an encouraging word, you can't miss God's purpose for your life if you really want it. You're looking at one young guy here, one young guy. One, I guess I'm young. I'm sorry, it's a default thing, you know, 62. How many think 62 is young? Everybody, boy, a lot of hands are up there. How many is older than 62? You want to admit that? Wow, I guess I am young. You know, God says, you can say, God, I'm willing to trust you. I might not understand it all. You know, it might not make any sense. But God, I know you have a good plan, and I want to serve you. Let's look at the third thing here. I must choose to trust and obey God. Can you write that down? I must choose to obey and trust God. Look at Deuteronomy 30. It says, today, God says, I give you a choice. God's not going to force His plan, His will on you. I'll give you a choice. I'm going to give you the choice between life and death. In other words, do you really want to live, or do you want to live a dead-end life? I give you a choice today between blessings or cursings. I want a blessed life. How many wants a blessed life in 2021? We make those choices. I give you this choice. And then look what the verse says. I call on heaven and earth to witness this. I witness this choice that you make between me and you. And then He says, I want everyone in my creation, and you hear the love of God here. He says, I want everybody, creation, to witness this. And then He says, so come, choose life, then you and your children will live. It's the choice is ours. And I'm here to tell you, I want to choose God. He has incredible blessings for us. Let's look at fact number four about our future. God says, God will be with me in every step of the way. Write that down. God will be with me in every step of the way. How do I know that? Well, one of the most repeated promises in the Bible are these phrases. As you go through this soap, as you read through the Bible, Genesis to Revelation, you're going to see these phrases over and over saying something like this. You'll read phrases like, you're not going to be alone. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will never abandon you. My presence is with you. Over and over, you're going to read that all the way through the entirety of the Bible. Hundreds of times, God says, I'm going to be with you, because God made you to have a connection with Him. And you may not always feel God, but God is not a feeling. Some things doesn't have to be felt in order to be real. You know, it's in this airspace right now. There's radio waves, and there's TV waves, and there's internet waves going through right now. And you don't feel them, but they're here. They're real. They're going through your body, you know, unless you have a receiver to tune them in. You don't have to feel something for it to be real. There's a lot of things that are real that you can't see. How many has ever seen a proton? How about an atom? How about an electron? We don't see those things, but they're very evident and very real. I may not feel God. I may not sense Him, but I'm going to let you know God is there. God is there, and we see His promises. In fact, Wendy sang this, great is thy faithfulness. God is so faithful, you can count on the promises of God to lead you through life, through COVID-19, through 2020, through 2021. God's presence is going to be with you through every step of the way, because God does not lie. His word is true. And many times we may not feel it, sense it, or it looks like things are going to hell in a handbasket. But God is faithful, and God's going to take us through. You know, one of the things I learned growing up is that when I was growing up in Virginia, I always wanted to go to lunch with my granddad because he always picked up the tab. I learned that going into college. If you're going to eat, if you're going to go somewhere, go with granddad. Granddad will always flip the bill. And knowing your Heavenly Father says, hey, I'm going to be with you. You don't have to worry, because God is going to be your helper and is part of His character. Now, on your outline, if you knew what God is really like, and he knew what he really promises, that you wouldn't be, if you knew his promises, if you knew how he, what he was really like, then you wouldn't be anxious or afraid about the future and what he promises to do in your life. So let me give you six promises real quick on your outline that's going to dramatically lower your fear of the future. Number one, promise number one, God's promises to guide me when I'm confused. He promises to guide me when I am confused. When I'm going into 2021, there's going to be a lot of decisions and choices that's going to be difficult and confusing and life-changing. Look at Proverbs 3. It says on your outline, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Never rely on what you think you know. Remember the Lord in everything you do, and you will, and he will show you the right way. If you trust him with all your heart, he'll show you the right way. Why trust God? Because he created you. He loved you. He knows everything about you. He sent his son to die for you. That's why we are celebrating communion. And he's completely reliable and trustworthy. He has a perspective about your life and your future that you desperately need in your life. And the only way to get that perspective is through the Word of God. And we're going to help you go through the soaps here. Help you go through the Word of God in 1 year, because how many knows 2020 was a crazy chaotic year, and you're down here from up north, and you're enjoying the Southwest Florida. We that live here year round, it's beautiful. How gorgeous is this? This is wonderful to be able to worship God outside. But why not get into God's Word and get some Word into you and get God's perspective for you and grow your spiritual walk with God? That Creator up there wants to connect with you. And we can do that through the Word of God. And that's what we're trying to intentionally get you to get into God's Word through soap and the 21 days of prayer and fasting. Look at promise number two. God promises to help you when I'm tempted. You know, you're probably going to face the same temptations that you've had for all your life. How many realizes that? Some of the temptations you had in 2021, you're going to have in 2021. Or 2020 and 2021. The weaknesses that you have, you're probably going to have the same struggles with for the rest of your life. It's your Achilles heel. God, Satan knows how, he knows your weaknesses. And you should get better in how to handle them as you grow older in the Lord. You know, for instance, maybe you have a predisposition on being controlling. Maybe you're a control freak. Maybe you heard that before. And you're trying to control everything and the rest of your life. And you're going to deal with that. You're going to have that tendency. And hopefully you get better and not give into it so much as you grow in your Lord. Some of you might be tempted to be in depression often. You find yourself moving in that. And if you're tempted to be depressed, then you learn how to bring into captivity your thoughts unto the obedience of Christ. And there's some temptations that you have that kind of knock on your door over and over again. In fact, let me give you the bad news, the good news, and the great news about temptation. The bad news is you're never going to outgrow temptation. Turn to your neighbor and say, oh boy. Some people think when I get saved and spirit-filled and I walk my walk with God, then the temptation in my flesh is going to end. No, you're in the flesh, and you're subject to that. In fact, Paul says, I crucify the flesh daily. So there are some things there that we're going to, as we grow up, as we grow in the Lord, you're always going to have the temptations that we find ourselves going through. And the Bible says, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. When Satan gives you an idea and puts it in your mind, that's called temptation. But when God puts an idea and a suggestion in your mind, that's called inspiration. For all you that are Lutheran background, Martin Luther said, you can't keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can keep them from building a nest in your hair. And that's what happens to temptation. You can't help the things going, whoo. And all of a sudden it hits you. You go, oh, wait a minute. Does that line up with God's word? You bring it under the captivity of God. So I should not feel guilty about a thought that goes, that you hit, blah, blah, blah. Where did that just come from? You take that thought and you line it up with God's word. Let me give you good news about temptation, is that it is not a sin to be tempted. It is a sin to give in to it, but it's not a sin to be tempted. The Bible says Jesus was tempted in every point like we, but he never sinned. Temptation is a choice, so don't get intimidated by it. We're all human. Every time you choose to do right and you resist temptation, you just grew stronger. Every time you resist temptation, you just gain strength in your spiritual life and in your body. Every time you resist or you choose to do wrong, you stumble, you're going back around the tree again. Temptation is just an opportunity to grow. So in 2021, when you're tempted, you're going, oh boy, it's a time to grow. So when you're tempted, that's the thought. Oh boy, God, we're growing, aren't we? It's a time to grow. I meet Christians all the time, and they get a thought in their heads, and they have an attraction, and they have an arousal, and they say, what's wrong with me? I read this week. Attraction is not a sin, action is. You're not responsible for your attractions. You're responsible for your actions. We all have different attractions. An attraction and arousal is not necessarily lust. It just means welcome to the human race. I can't control what gets my attention, but I can control what keeps my attention. So you hear the difference there. So anyhow, that's the good news about temptation. We're all going to have it. The bad news is this: you're never going to outgrow it. The good news is it's not a sin to be tempted. The best news is this: God's promised to provide a way out of it. Look on your outline. Remember that temptation that comes in your life are no different from what others experience. In other words, everybody in human race are common. Temptations are common. And then let me just say, if they're common, then there should be a common solution. And if we would just share the same temptations, that we just talk about it with each other, you know what? They'll lose its power. When you have a temptation, you keep a secret, then it's going to get worse. Someone once said, you're as sick as your secrets are. So when we get them out and get them in the light, we have an opportunity to deal with them. If we would do more confession of temptation, there would be less need to confess sin, because that's where we stop it early. And then look on that outline there. Look, Jesus says it's not a sin; it's a sin to give in. Remember, and he goes, God is faithful. And then look how he promises to help us. He will keep the temptation from becoming so strong that you can't stand up against it. That's the first promise. And then the second is he'll show you a way out so that you'll not give in to it. God knows exactly your struggles. And Jesus experienced those same temptations. It's spiritual warfare. It's an opportunity to grow. Let's look at the third promise about our future. God promises to support me in trouble. He promises to support me in trouble. What's the difference between temptation and trouble? Temptation is an inside job. Trouble is an outside job. Temptation is internal. Trouble is external. Temptation has to do with my character. Trouble has to do with my circumstance. And for the rest of your life, because we live in a broken planet, you're going to have temptations and troubles. Internal temptations, external troubles. It's spiritual warfare. Jesus says, in this world, you will have tribulation. There's going to be relational troubles. There's going to be financial troubles. There's going to be health issues. There's going to be mental troubles. Don't turn to your neighbor, but there's going to be mental trouble. So don't blame God for the evil. God cannot do evil. God's will is not always done on this earth. That's why we pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so we will have our troubles. And in 2021, troubles will come. Look at one of the great promises in the Bible on your outline, Isaiah 43. When you go through deep waters. Can you circle the word when? It doesn't say if. It's not an if. When you go through deep waters in great trouble, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulties, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, when the heat's on, you will not be burned up. For I am the Lord your God. And then it says, you're not going to be burned up. I'm going to be with you to make sure you make it through. Let's look at promise number four. God's promises to repay those who hurt me. He promises to repay those who hurt me. In other words, he says, let me handle it. Have you noticed that the world has become meaner and more hateful and more rude, uncivil, more unfair? And the truth is, life's not fair. Sometimes bad people win. Have you noticed that? Sometimes good people suffer. Have you noticed sometimes the innocent gets hurt? Have you noticed that sometimes well-meaning people get abused or betrayed or cheated on or heartbroken? And if you've been discriminated against because of your race, your culture, your language, your gender, if you've been abused or you've been harassed or you've been mistreated as your pastor, let me say, I'm sorry for that hurt. God also grieves with you during that whole time. But look at Romans 12, what Paul talks to us in the Word of God, the next promise. Never avenge yourself. Leave that to God, for he has said that he will repay those who deserve it. Wow. God is a loving God, and this, let me say, God is a God of justice. He's a fair God. He's a righteous God. Why? Because to allow evil to hurt his children and not seek justice would be unloving. Justice is sometimes the loving thing to do and protection. If somebody tries to hurt my wife or my children or my grandkids and I did nothing about it and I didn't care about it, that's called being unloving. Sometimes love fights. Sometimes love defends. Sometimes love fights back for the protection of others. The Bible says greater is he, greater love has no man than this, that he laid his life down for his friends. But here's the catch to that. God is saying to us in 2021, those offenses that's come against us, God says, I don't want you to waste 1 second of your life on resentment, on retaliation, on revenge, or getting even, because it's going to fill your mind and spirit with a bitterness of poison. Poison of bitterness. I don't want you to waste your precious life being bitter. And some of you are still allowing people 10 years ago that offended you still come back and still holding that in your memory. You realize they can't hurt you anymore, that it's your past is your past. And the only way that they can hurt you is you're holding on to the past. And God says, I want you to let it go not because they deserve it, because they don't. Let me ask you, do you deserve forgiveness? We all have things that we've done in our lives. But you let it go because you go, I want to get on with my life. Justice delayed is not justice denied. The Bible says there's going to be a day of reckoning, a day of an accounting, a day of judgment. And God is very aware of what people have done to you on this earth. And he's going to settle the accounts one day. Look at promise number 5. About your future. God promises to reward my service and generosity. Reward my service and generosity. Part of God's plan and purpose for your life is to become more like Christ. And what is Jesus like? Well, one word, he's unselfish. The whole goal of life is learning how to become more and more unselfish, because to be unselfish is love. God wants you to be like him. God is love. Nothing is more selfish than a brand new baby. Have you ever noticed that? How many has ever watched your one-year-old lately? Or your two-year-old? Man, they coo and they goo, but man, they are selfish little burgers, aren't they? And the only way that they can start growing up, they got to learn how to share. And it is our nature to only think of us, me, not to think about you. It's our nature. It's our carnal nature to do that. And so God wants us to become like him, like Jesus. On Mark 10, it's not on your outline, says this. Jesus said, I didn't come to this earth to be served. I didn't come to live for myself. I came to serve and to give my life for many. Those are two verbs that describe the Christian life, serving and giving. Those two words describe what it means to be a Christ follower, to serve and to give. If you're not serving and you're not giving, then those are verbs there that says you're not acting like a Christian. It's learning to be unselfish. It's learning real love. How do you spell love? G-I-V-E, give. Because you cannot give without loving, and you cannot love without giving. Look on your outline. God is not unfair. He will not forget how hard you have worked for him and how you have shown your love for him by helping his people as they continue to do. God is going to reward you, but that's nothing compared to the reward that you're going to get in heaven. And that reward in heaven is going to be based on what you did with your talents and your gifts on this earth. One day you're going to stand before God, and God's going to say, what did you do with what you were given, your time, your money, your talent? Well, I made a lot of money, Lord. and I retired in Southwest Florida. And then I died. God's going to say, wrong answer. You're here much more than that, to do much more. You are giving back in a way. Are you giving back in a way, in a volunteer way, that you can't get repaid for? And God says, you're going to be rewarded for that. Your service and what you've done for me and for others. By the way, it's the same with your giving. Look on your outline. Jesus says this, use your worldly resources, that's money, to benefit others. In other words, don't just spend all your money on yourself, but help other people, support the work of God. And it goes on. We're making friends for eternity. In this way, your generosity stores up a reward for you in heaven, and you're going to be rewarded. The Bible says no service, no reward in heaven, no generosity, no treasure stored in heaven. Are you sending it ahead? Only one life will soon be passed, and only what's done for Christ will last. I won't make any apologies. You know, when you get to heaven one day, can you imagine being up in heaven about 100 years, you're up there, and somebody comes up to you, or 50 years from the day, they come up to you and say, hey, did you go to that Springs Church down there? You were part of that Springs Church, weren't you? You know, 50 years ago, I know I didn't get to meet you, but you were one of those pioneers down there. You helped give. You helped serve in there. You set chairs up. You helped make that service possible. And because of that, I had an opportunity to come to know Christ. It's because of your service I'm able to be up here today. I just want to thank you. That's what sending in ahead is. And it's going to be worth it all. And then lastly, in promise number 6, God promises for my future to keep me saved until heaven. Three verses. Here's three promises, and then we'll close this out. John 10:28. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. It's a gift. He doesn't take it back. And no one can snatch them out of my hands. When you put your hand in God's hands, there's times you're going to be tempted to let go, but God won't. How many has ever let go of God's hand in your life a couple times in your life? How many has ever took a crooked path? And all of a sudden you find yourself back. But you gave your heart to the Lord a long time ago. But you kind of got off the beaten path. I'm going to tell you what, God's got his hand on you. I don't know what my future is going to hold. I don't know how many years Russ Wynn has. I jokingly tell my grandkids and my kids I like to make it to the Smucker's jelly jar pitcher, Lord willing, if I have my mind and everything. I might lose everything. Who knows about my future? I might lose my health. I might lose my wife. Who knows? I might lose my family. I might even lose my mind, Jerry. But I love you too, brother. I'm not saying you lost your mind. You're mentally stable. I can say that. But I'm never, listen, going to lose my salvation. That's good news. He's never going to stop loving me. He's going to keep me until I'm safely home. That's a promise, 2021 and beyond. Well, what happens if I messed up? Well, look at this next verse. 2 Timothy, if you are faithless, he, God, will remain faithful, for he cannot disown himself. That's how much God loves you. Look at the last verse. Be confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. What God starts in your life, he's going to finish. God never leaves anything half finished. So you can be confident of this, that what God has started in your life so many years ago or just maybe recently, he's going to finish it out as we keep our walk and as we walk to him and develop our relationship with him. God's hand is going to be on us. So, Church of the Living God, as we enter into 2021, can I just say, walk with your head up, your chest out, with a smile on your face, with a skip in your step, with the joy in your heart, because if God be for us, who can be against us? We serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. We have a blessed future ahead of us. Like I said, I don't know what 2021 is, but I thank God I got my hand in the hand of the man that's going to take us all the way to the end. That's our future as a church. So Satan, bring it on. Bring it on. And whatever you give me and come against me, and whatever comes against you, have confidence because of the promises of God of our future. It's a wonderful promise for those who walk faithfully and trust Him. Let's bow our heads right now. Lord, thank you, Lord. And Lord, as we look to you, God, we want to thank you for all that you've done for us. You already know how my life's going to end. You know all the problems that we're going to have. You know all the mistakes that we're going to make. But yet, God, you still love us. You still have a good plan for us. And what I'm saying today is, as a church and all of us here, as we unite our prayers together, I want the rest of our lives to be on your plan system, not on mine. I want to live the rest of my life for you. Can you tell God that? I want to live the rest of my life for you, not for myself, but for you. Lord, I'm not going to waste any more time and life and energy on bitterness and resentment and retaliation and all that garbage, holding on to things in the past, people that have died and they're still reaching out from, I'm allowing people from the grave to come back and snatch my peace. Lord, I want to let it go. Let go of that bitterness and that anger. God, help me. Let it go. Because I want to walk in the peace that passeth all understanding. If you've never invited Jesus into your life, would you do this right now? Would you say right now, God, come into my life. Say, Jesus Christ, come in. Just tell him that. Be the manager of my life. Take control of it. Tell him that. I want my life to be built on your plans for 2021. Not my plans, but yours. I want to learn to follow you. I want to be a Christ follower. I pray this humbly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, we went through 7,000 promises by 7:30. I mean 10:30. Praise the Lord. Well, God bless you. Hey, those of you that just made that commitment to Christ, up here is a book, and it's called What on Earth Am I Here For? And it's a little booklet I want to put in your hand. Just stop over there, and we will put this in your hand. Those of you that have just recently come to know the Lord and rededicated your life, pick this book up here. It will help you in your walk with the Lord. Wendy's going to come to lead us in our last song to end our service. And those of you that are watching online, thank you for being part of our service. There is an online app to give, and we want to thank you for every week, your faithfulness in doing that on that online app. We want to say thank you. We recognize that, and we appreciate that. And the offering baskets, as you leave today, you can drop your offering in the baskets there. God bless you. We love you. We have a wonderful future ahead of us. Wendy, sing us one last song as we leave here.
Great sermon. Let's hear it for our awesome pastor. Yeah, I am so on fire. I'm about to do the charismatic run around the park. Come on now. Woo! Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, we praise you now. Woo! Hallelujah. Come on. Bring your tithe and bring your shame. Bring your guilt and bring your pain. Don't you know that's not your name? Cause you will always be much more than me. Every day I wrestle with the voices that keep telling me I'm not right. But that's all right, right? Cause I hear a voice and he calls me redeemer. When others say I'll never be enough, in Christ is the one living inside of me. The he who is living in the world, in the world, in the world. Living inside of me than he who is living in the world. Woo! Yeah. Bring your doubts and bring your fears. Bring your hurt, love, and bring our tears. There'll be no confidence. proclamation here. You are holy, righteous, and redeemed. Love you guys.
And every day I fall, there'll be those who tell me a mistake.
But that's okay, cause I hear a voice and he calls me redeemed. When others say I'll never be enough, then greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world. In the world, love you guys. In the world, and greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in. He's greater. He's greater. Says that it doesn't matter, cause the cross already won the war. I'm freely understanding just how you see me, and it makes me love you more and more. There'll be days I lose the battle, grace that it doesn't matter, cause the cross already won the war. I'm learning to run freely, understanding just how you see me, and it makes me love you more and more. And there is a voice, and he calls me redeemed. When others say I'll never be enough, then greater is the one living inside me than he who is living in the world. In the world.